discussion about payment channel networks. So recall that there are two parts of this payment channel network. One is a single bidirectional payment channel, and the second is how we put these different channels together to form a payment channel network. So we've been talking about the first part, which is just a single bidirectional payment channel. Okay, so essentially what we do is that we first have to have a funding transaction in which both parties deposit some money and they lock it up. Only both of them together can unlock it, right? And the question is how to do that. And we said we must do it in such a way that we should be able to punish somebody who tries to unlock it with old information. So we said what we do is that initially we create these commitments which tell us what the current balances are of the two nodes. So initially we said both put in 0.5, right? So both have 0.5 over here. And later on what we are going to do is we are going to update these balances and create new commitments. But if somebody tries to broadcast an old commitment, he should be punished. And the way we said we are going to do this is by creating commitments of this kind. One of the outputs is going to have something called an ISMC, and the other is going to be a normal output. Right? So in this particular case, this is A's commitment. A has created, A and B have sort of together created this, and it is only half signed by B. So B doesn't know what this full commitment is going to look like, because it doesn't have this signature. So that is a key point. Right, but this commitment says that if it is broadcast, B can immediately get his money with no problem. Right, but A has to wait for some time. A has to wait, we said, 1,000 blocks. That's the example given in the Lightning Network paper. Okay, but that's just a sort of just as an example. It could be 100 or 10 blocks or whatever. But A has to wait for some time to get his money. Right? If he has the cooperation of B, he can immediately get his money. But if he wants to take this money himself alone by signing a transaction with secret key A3, then he has to wait 1,000 blocks. Okay, and that 1,000 blocks time is going to give B enough of time to punish him if at all he's trying to cheat by sending an old commitment. Okay, and so we said there are two commitments. One is with A, and there is also a commitment by B which looks similar, and I'll just write that out over here. Let's say that 0 here is, I'm just writing in this way, B and A 0.5, and there's going to be other keys that we use, right? So there's going to be a key for B and a key for A. Okay, we have to appropriately number it. And output 1, which is going to give 0.5 BTC to A. Okay, and it would be half signed by A. So okay, so this is what we've looked at, and of course it would have to be fully signed by B once B wants to broadcast it. Okay. So both parties have their own commitments. They have the half signed commitment shown here in black from the other party, and they can create their own signature shown here in red and broadcast it at any time. Okay. So notice that B does not have the full C1A because it doesn't have the signature. If it broadcasts the half signed one, that would be an invalid transaction. Right? And similarly, A cannot broadcast this full transaction because it does not have this signature. Okay. So we are at this stage, and now we want to know how exactly each party is going to punish the other. Okay. So let's say that okay. So this was maybe just a recap of this. This is how they can pay out. So suppose C1A is broadcast, A can take his money even if B has disappeared, but he has to wait a little while. But with B's cooperation, they can create this transaction and A can get all his money, right? And from the second output, B can get his money immediately. So the question now is, what do we do if somebody tries to cheat? So suppose they have made a payment. So suppose A has paid 0.1 to B. Okay, so they initially started out with 0.5, 0.5, and now it has become, after this payment, this is the initial amount in the funding transaction, it has become 0.4, 0.6. Okay, so this is the update. Now they have to create a new set of commitments corresponding to this balance. So C2A and C2B are going to include this. So how are we going to do that? So what is C2A going to look like? Let's say that, so it has input from the funding transaction. So notice that none of this is actually on the blockchain, only the funding transaction has been put on the blockchain. Right? But these commitments are all kept privately with A and B. Okay? So of course we had to be careful, we said, while creating this funding transaction. First we had to create C1A and C1B, at least the half signed version. And only then fully create the funding transaction and broadcast it. Right? Because otherwise there was a worry that money would be locked in the funding transaction forever if the other party refused to help in creating the commitments. Okay, so just let's recap. So the recap is, first create half signed C1A, C1B, and then create signed funding transaction, and then broadcast funding transaction to the miners, right? That's what we did earlier. Now we want to update the balances. So we want to say that these are old, C1A and C1B are old, and we want to create C2A and C2B. So now it's going to look like this. So we have the outputs, and the first output is going to be an RSMC like before, and the balance is going to be 0.4 BTC. And the keys that we are going to include, let's call them PKA5 and PKB6. And output 1 is going to just go to B, let's say 0.6 BTC, and it goes to, let's say, PKB7. Okay, and so similarly, there's going to be a C2B, and you can work out the details. It's exactly going to be a mirror image of here, but there the RSMC is going to be for B, so it should have 0.6, and the other output, which is meant for A, should have 0.4, right? Okay, so So anyway, so this is the state we are in. We've created this, but how is anybody to know which is the old transaction? Right, so C2A looks almost identical to C1A. It's just that the amounts here are different. Okay, this amount has become 0.6 from 0.5, and this has decreased from 0.5 to 0.4. So the problem here is, what if A tries to cheat and sends out C1A? So let me summarize what we have done till now. So in the real world, A says that I am creating, let's say this is the AB channel. We had 0.5, 0.5. Now in the real world, A says I want to pay you 0.1, you give me something in return. So I mean this was in C1 A, C1 B. Okay, this information was captured there. So A says I want to pay you 0.1. So the way they do that is they effectively create new commitments. So there is C2A, C2B, which is capturing this information. Right? Each of them captures this full information, saying who has how much. Now what I want is that if A tries to cheat and broadcast this one to spend from the funding transaction, then B should be able to punish him. And the question is how to do that, because both are valid transactions. So C1A and C2A are both valid, meaning that they can both spend from the funding transaction. Okay, so what we really have now, what we've created is this is the funding transaction, this is on the blockchain. And we have created many ways of spending from it. There is C1A, there is C2A, C1B, C2B. Any of these transactions that broadcast can be included in the blockchain, and they can spend from this funding transaction. Okay. So what we want to say now is that these are old, and these are new. So how are we going to say what is old and new? Because let's say in the real world, A has created C2A, C2B, right? And so that's equivalently giving 0.1 BTC to B. So B gives something in return to A. Maybe he's bought a book or whatever, right? 0.1 is a lot of money, right? It may be $1,000. So could have bought something really a lot from B, and B gave those goods in return for this 0.1. Now A tries to cheat and he tries to send out C1A, which gives him 0.5 instead of his 0.4. So to our advantage, we know that A has to wait for 1,000 blocks before he can actually use the money in C1A from that RSMC. It is locked for 1,000 blocks. But what can B do in that time period? Okay, so there may be multiple ways of doing it, but we look at how they do it in the paper by Poon and Dria, and that paper has been uploaded to Moomin. Right? So let's think about it. So we are creating this C2A, right? And let's look at this C1A. Okay, so C1A has a particular RSMC which has keys PKA3 and PKB4. Now what we are going to say is that Before, let's say finishing C2A, C2B creation, there has to be a way of punishing A if he sends this out. So how to do it, and what we are going to do is we are going to use this option, the second option over here. So notice that if any transactions is signed by both SKA3 and SKB4, it can immediately spend from the RSMC. Whereas if it is signed only by SKA3, that particular transaction has to wait 1,000 blocks before it is included by any miner in the blockchain. Right? No miner can include this transaction before 1,000 blocks after this transaction has been included in the blockchain. Okay? So how are we going to do it? So it's a very unusual solution of the authors. Okay, so very, very peculiar. And the way it's done is that A will have to give his secret key corresponding to this. Secret key B4 to B. Okay, and the opposite is also true for the appropriate RSMC of C2 of C1B. B would have to give the appropriate secret key to A. Okay, and just let me see. And similarly, we can say for C2 C1B. So this is very unusual because you never give a secret key to anyone. It's supposed to be secret. Okay, but the way this is set up, you are giving control of this RSMC to B. Okay, so what B can do is, if you try to cheat, he can actually take all your money. Okay, so let's look at this again. Let's just write down old commitments. So there is C1A over here, and we had in the outputs, we had the first output was an RSMC 0.5 BTC, and we said the keys are PKA3 and SKB4. Is that right? Let me just. Okay. And here we just had the amount, which was locked for public key B3. So this should be public key. Okay, so what we are saying is that so at least before we finished with the full C2A business, C2A and C2B, these two keys, both the secret keys corresponding to this, should be with B. Okay, so suppose, so let's just note that down. So after, or let's say when C2A, C2B created, both SKA3 and SKB4 are known to be. Okay, so let's see what were these signed by. This was signed by SKB2, and this was a half signed commitment, and SKA2, right? This could have been created by A privately. Okay, so Recall that B only has the half signed transaction, it doesn't have the full signed C1A. So B knows the contents of C1A, the main contents, but it doesn't have the appropriate signature for it. It does not have this. So if C1A is not broadcast, B cannot take this money. I mean, because if B wants to steal this money over here, he would first have to recreate the full C1A, broadcast the full C1A, and then create a transaction to take this money. Okay, so A is still protected, but suppose A tries to cheat by sending out C1A. Now what does B do? B is going to immediately spend from this what is called a breach remedy transaction. So let's just call it BR1A. And what is it going to have? It's going to say B can pretty much do anything because he has both the keys for this. Right? So he signs it with the secret key A3 and B4. So he can do anything in this transaction. He has both the signatures, so he just could just give himself the money, right? So he could say that 0.5 BTC is I'm giving it to my, let's say, an own public key, right? I just have create a fifth public key and give all the money to it. So B has, if A tries to cheat, B can immediately take this. And remember that there is also this other RD1 which allowed revocable delivery where A gets the money, but this has to wait for 1000 locks. So suppose B is sort of listening to the blockchain, he's listening to everything that's happening. He knows that they have created C2A, C2B. He's confident that he has the keys to spend from this RSMC. I mean, he knows what is there in the RSMC because after all, he created this original signature, SKB2. He knows the contents of this RSMC. So if he sees that C1A has been broadcast and gets into the blockchain, okay, he knows that A will still have to wait 1000 blocks to get his money. So in the meantime, during those 1000 blocks, he broadcasts this breach remedy, which is signed properly to immediately take the money from this RSMC. So B punishes A by taking all the RSMC money. Okay, so this is good because if A is cheating, then he's losing all his money. So what has effectively happened? If A sent out this old commitment, he loses all his own money, and this money of course can be spent anytime by B. Okay, so this of course belongs to B and it can be spent at any time. So it's a clever idea, but gets a bit tricky because you're giving secret keys to the other party, which is very unusual. Okay, so what you're doing is that you first create commitments and you only have them half signed so that the other party doesn't know what they are, doesn't know the full commitment, so that he cannot broadcast the old commitment. Okay. And then every time you do a payment across the channel, you just create new commitments which reflect those new balances. And you also have to give your secret keys corresponding to the old RSMCs to the other party so that they are confident that if the other person tries to cheat, then you can do this. You can create a breach remedy and take all the money in the payment channel. Everything will belong to you. So very clever scheme. So just to just summarize what we have done here. So first of all, let's say that this is the blockchain. Okay, so what we do is we first create C1A, C1B half sign, and then we create funding transaction. Okay, and the funding transaction, let's say we put on the blockchain. So let's say that the funding goes in here. Okay, so both are confident. Even if the other party disappears, they can just send the appropriate commitment and get back their money. That's not a problem. Now A pays B some amount, 0.1. So what they do is they exchange secret keys for RSMCs of C1A, C1B, and they create C2A and C2B, right? Okay, and this continues, and let's say A pays 0.2 again to B, then they would create C3A, C3B, right, to reflect this, and they would have to exchange secret keys of C2A, C2B, right, of RSMCs of C2A, C2B. Right, so you have to be careful that these RSMC keys are not used elsewhere, right? Because if you're using it as a public key somewhere else and you hand out the secret key for him, then that person can use the money which is locked up in that public key, right? So you would not want to use the public keys of an RSMC anywhere else, right? Now of course somebody can if somebody tries to broadcast, let's say C2A gets in here, this is an old transaction, an old commitment. What B can do is he could send out breach remedy 2A and B gets all the money over here. Okay? And A of course can't take the money from his RSMC immediately, he has to wait 1000 blocks. So this particular transaction beats that transaction. Even if he broadcasts it later on, there is no UTXO available because the RSMC UTXO has already been used here by this breach remedy. So the RSMC output is no longer a UTXO once this has been broadcast. Right? So that's something to note. So the Bitcoin rules take care of it. So this, if at all, revocable RD, what's the term for it? Revocable delivery RD2A was sent to spend from the RSMC, it would not get into the blockchain. So it would not enter the blockchain. Okay, so this is the overall idea of how a payment channel works. So it's a little bit of a tricky thing, and essentially the idea is that you're creating a smart contract between two parties. So they lock money just in that smart contract, and then they update the payout, the commitment transactions appropriately to reflect the latest balance. And what they have done is they have ensured that if the other party either disappears, runs away, That's not a problem because this particular party can get his money back, whatever is the balance. Okay. And they also make sure that the other party cannot send an old commitment which reflects an old balance, because then this particular party can take all the money. Right? So nobody can cheat over here, and that's taken care of. So we have effectively made use of the idea of a smart contract in order to solve this problem. Okay? And it's like as if your smart contract is some sort of a tank, right? Or it's some sort of a capacitor which has initially taken this charge, and little bit of charge can be shifted from one plate to the other. There are a few small things I wanted to discuss just about bidirectional payment channels. And one is how to close the channel. So the first option we talked about is through commitments. So what we said is any party broadcasts his commitment. And so it would send the commitment transaction to the miners, and it gets into the blockchain. And then he can later on spend from his RSMC, which is there in the commitment transaction. Right? So the other option is that they can get together. Okay, so maybe I should say, and then spend from the RSMC. The other option is that they can mutually get together and directly create a new settlement transaction which takes from the funding transaction. So there's the funding transaction, which is already in the blockchain, and you know, we said that this can be used using C1A, C1B and so on, but if they want, they can just terminate the channel by just creating a new transaction which we'll call the settlement transaction. So the term used in the paper is exercise settlement. ES transaction. So this too takes as input from the funding transaction, and the outputs, just say, let's say that, you know, let's say that A has paid, or let's say maybe they haven't paid anything, so they started out with 0.5 and 0.5. Okay, so let's say that 0.5 goes to A and right, 0.5 to B, right? And of course, if they had already made some payment, suppose we had reached C2A and C2B, and let's say A had paid 0.1 to B, then of course then too they could end it with a settlement transaction where 0.4 goes to A and 0.6 to B. Okay. So if they mutually agree, they don't have to use the commitments. These commitments are there just in case the other party misbehaves. Okay. And normally you would expect them to use something like these ES transactions in order to just close out the channel. Okay. So few things I wanted to discuss. So first is I wanted to ask a few questions. So how fast are transactions on these payment channels? Or maybe I should say, how fast are payments on payment channels. So this is referring back to the confirmation time. So remember that in Bitcoin we said you may have to wait 1 hour if you want six confirmations. What about here? How fast are these payments? So they start out with A, let's say 0.5, and B has pledged 0.5. And A wants to pay, let's say 0.1. How long does it take to make this 0.1 payment? So think about it, they initially have C1A and C1B, and what they want here is they want C2A and C2B. So some messages have to be exchanged and some keys have to be exchanged and so on in order to create this, right? There's a procedure which we discussed earlier, right? So they need to send each other the half signed commitment transactions and so on, and exchange keys, and then that's sort of going to ensure that the latest commitments are C2A, C2B, and the old ones are invalid. And they don't really have to wait for anything on the blockchain because none of this is going on the blockchain. So it's not affected at all by the blockchain. It's totally off the chain. These are all not on the chain. So really the time for the payment is the time to create C2A and C2B. And that could be much faster than anything that happens on the blockchain, much faster than an hour. Right, it may take a few seconds to create this. Right, so there is some A and B are located on different parts of the internet, so it takes some time to send messages and send it back and so on. Right, but essentially all of that is automated, so it may take of the order of hundreds of milliseconds to create this. So it could be hundreds of milliseconds to create C2A, C2B. And really that is the amount of time it takes to make this payment. Okay, so we've sort of decoupled this payment channel from the actual blockchain. So we are not stuck with these 10-minute delays of blocks and so on. Right? So once you've created this payment channel, so how do you know that you've created it? Well, you put the funding transaction on the blockchain and that has got deep enough, right? Then you're sort of confident that that funding transaction has enough confirmation, so it'll be there forever. And from then onwards, you can make a lot of these micro payments to each other of the order of hundreds of milliseconds. And you know, A could pay B, B could pay A small amounts and so on. Right? So it's much faster than confirmation time on the blockchain. So, second question that I want to ask is what is the cost of this? I mean, so here, is there something we lose by going to the payment channel? So B has got 0.1 from A, so the balances are 0.4 and 0.6. But has B lost something over here? I mean, is there any difference, or is it same as identical to suppose A had made 0.1 payment on the blockchain? So clearly, this is faster, we saw that, but is there something that is being lost? And we might want to think, what happens if B stops listening to the blockchain? So normally in a Bitcoin transaction, if A pays B, B just either of them can just broadcast the transaction, it gets into the blockchain, and B waits for a few confirmations, and then he knows that that's the end of the matter. B doesn't have to listen anymore to the blockchain. He could just disconnect from the internet or completely from other miners, right? But here, what is going to happen if B stops listening to the blockchain? Now the problem is that A might broadcast C1A. This is a problem, and get 0.5 BTC rather than 0.4. So this is a little bit dangerous. So B can always catch A if he sends some old transaction and can punish him. But provided that he's listening to the blockchain, he's seeing what transactions get into the blockchain. So he has about 1,000 blocks time, we said, in order to punish A. But if B goes offline and thinks that he has got his 0.1, then he could be in trouble. Okay, but of course it's a little bit tricky for A too, because if A needs to know that B is offline before he broadcasts C1A. Because if B comes online after he's broadcast C1A, before those 1,000 blocks have expired, then B could take all the money. Right? But suppose A knows that B has gone on a vacation or something into some island where there is no internet connectivity, and he's not listening to the blockchain, then A might just broadcast C1A and collect a higher amount. So what we are losing here is that both A and B have to be continuously listening to the listening to the blockchain to ensure that the other has not broadcast any old commitment. Right, so that is what they lose over here, even though the transaction is immediate, very quick compared to doing it on the blockchain. They sort of have to listen to the channel and try to find out if the other is cheating. Okay. Then the third question I want to ask. Suppose A deposits 0.5 and B deposits 0.5 in this payment channel. They can make small amounts of payments, right? 0.3, let's say. Okay, and after all of this, what is the balance? Well, this is going to be 0.8 and this is going to be 0.2. Okay. The question is there any limit to this? So clearly there is no limit on these small interactions. They can make a large number of them. But we have to see that the net flow in a particular direction cannot be more than the initial amount deposited. So the net transaction in this direction has to be less than 0.5, or less than or equal to 0.5. And similarly, the net amount paid in the other direction has to be less than 0.5. Okay, so the initial amount, so the question is, what is the maximum net amount A can pay B? And the answer is, of course, 0.5, whatever is the initial amount. So once the payment channel is created, they can pay small amounts to each other, but the total flow, so to speak, in any one direction cannot exceed what was initially deposited. So if A wants to pay B more than 0.5, let's say initially, he can't do it over this payment channel, right? But of course, if B has paid, let's say, some amount here, okay, so let's look at this stage. Suppose we are at this stage where 0.2 is with A and 0.8 is with B. B could pay up to 0.8 in this direction because he has balance of 0.8. But effectively, the net amount B has paid A is still going to be less than 0.5. Okay, that's reflected, that's captured by these balances. Okay, so Lightning Network, suppose, I mean, we haven't talked about a multi-hop payment channel, but But if somebody wants to use this channel to pay somebody else, he will not be able to pay more than 0.5, okay, whatever is the balance over here. Okay. So effectively the net amount that can be pushed across is equal to the initial balance in the payment channel. What else? What are some other issues? So fourth question I want to ask, what about transaction fees? So we saw that in Bitcoin, each transaction had to give some incentive to the miner to include that transaction in a block. So it had to pay some amount of fee, even a small amount. Here, do A and B have to pay each other anything? Well, the answer is, we'll have to think, does it cost them at all? So what, A and B have deposited, let's say 0.5, and let's say their intention is just to pay each other. Okay, and so here if the transactions are just between A and B, lots of transactions between A and B, why would they charge each other any transaction fee? Right? They wouldn't, if it's just between the two of them, it's like giving a note of cash to each other, and they can keep doing that any number of times and they don't pay any fee. Right? So theoretically the transaction fees could be zero. You don't have to pay anything to each other. Right? But you might think that suppose there are, when we go to multi-hop, we might have to go through this channel AB, C may have to go through AB to pay D. And then A and B might leverage some transaction fee, right? So that would have to be included in the way they make this transaction across multiple hops. We haven't yet discussed this, right? But if there is just payment between A and B, they could have transaction fee zero, okay? But it's really depending on the context in which the payment is made. Transaction fees can be charged or not. I shouldn't say transaction fees, maybe I should just call it fees. Or maybe I should call it payment channel network fees. Okay, so I mean by as an example, if A pays B, they could just give it, right? There could be no transaction fee. All they have to do is just send some update the commitments. But if C pays A who pays B who pays D, right? A and B can leverage some transaction fee. Okay, what are some issues? What are some other issues? So what do we lose by having to, first of all, even creating this payment channel? I think we were on question four. What else do we lose? By creating a payment channel. So A and B have both deposited 0.5. And it could be higher, whatever they want to put in. So the thing is, this money has been locked. It's locked till the channel is terminated. So this amount was put in anticipation of future payments. It's not put in to make a particular transaction. So normally when you make a Bitcoin transaction, you actually pay A pays B some amount. Here they've locked their money in this funding transaction. Right? I'll just write that here. This is funding transaction. So they both locked up 0.5, and that is just anticipating future transaction between the two of them. But it's possible that they don't make any transactions between each other, and then the money is just stuck there. Right? So it's just sitting over there. So that is a problem, that your money, once you put it in the Lightning Network, it's locked until you actually break the channel and you settle it. Either you do it either by transmitting your commitment, or you join with the other party to create a settlement transaction, right? An ES transaction, which we just discussed. Okay? So that this is also another price to pay. Okay? That once you get into the Lightning Network, some of your money is locked up there. Okay. So there are some trade-offs, but it's a very interesting idea in that you can make transactions really quickly. You can have virtually zero transaction fees. And you can pay each other any number of times. You know, A can pay B, B can pay A, and so on. That can be done any number of times. And all of this is done off the blockchain. Okay, and if it is done cleverly, then it can avoid all sorts of attacks where either one party disappears or he tries to cheat by sending an old commitment and so on. Okay. So in the next lecture, we will talk about how to make payments across multiple payment channels in the Lightning Network.